Hi, it's Dwyer, gamblersadvisory.com, DwyerVIP.com. On Roku, in the sports section, Dwyer Boxing and Sports News. On iTunes, one word, Dwyer Boxing News. Remember, the opinion you should follow should be your own. Just consider this video to be a second opinion from a complete stranger online. Today is October 11th, 2014. There is a great article on BoxingScene.com that quotes championship trainer Freddie Roach. Freddie Roach makes the point that if he had trained Alexander Povetkin against Vladimir Klitschko, he's 100% sure that Alexander Povetkin would have beaten Vladimir Klitschko. You know, I don't mean to be a contrarian here, right? Before that fight took place, and you can look at the pre-fight and post-fight videos here online, I predicted that Alexander Povetkin would beat Vladimir Klitschko. Don't get me wrong, Vladimir Klitschko has been an excellent champion. There's no question about it. He's an elite. He's held the belt for a long time. He's turned back big challengers, right? David Haye, for example, he beat, right? Tony Thompson, he beat twice, knocked out twice, right? These are credible opponents. An unbeaten Marius Wach, he beat him. Eddie Chambers, he beat him, right? Vladimir Klitschko is legit. I'm not here to suggest otherwise. But styles make fights. This is the contrarian part of the internet in that we'll boldly go wherever the film takes us. Now, I thought Povetkin made several mistakes in the fight. I've discussed them here in the post-fight video way back when. But what I want you to do is to compare and contrast Alexander Povetkin's movement against Vladimir Klitschko, where he keeps trying to come inside and he keeps getting tied up. Compare and contrast that with Miguel Cotto's movement against Sergio Martinez. Keep in mind, Cotto was trained for that fight by Freddie Roach. There's a certain art to picking when to attack, right? You shouldn't be so obvious that the other guy is able to routinely tie you up. Now understand, Alexander Povetkin, at least in my opinion, is one of the best athletes in the heavyweight division. When I say that, what I mean is that if every heavyweight were to do a decathlon, I would expect Alexander Povetkin to be at the very top, right? This is a guy who moves well, who, you know, is two-handed, who has relatively fast hands, who is able to bend his body and do things in a less robotic fashion than other heavyweights. He fought the wrong fight, right? I believe with the right style, with more of an in and out game, with more unpredictability, right? Where a fighter is coming in with the kind of hard power shots, he's leading with the kind of power shots that Miguel Cotto led with, right? A guy who can come in low on Vladimir Klitschko in a way where Klitschko can't just tuck the guy under his arm. I think that kind of fighter can beat Vladimir Klitschko. I know it sounds preposterous. I understand the casinos disagree. I understand the boxing public disagrees. As I've said, the only unbeaten I've seen in boxing long term has been Father Time, right? History is replete with great fighters getting beaten, right? Alexander Povetkin against Vladimir Klitschko remains an intriguing matchup if Povetkin can get the right kind of instruction from his corner. Let's talk about another fight I've commented on in the past. It's now been announced by the WBC that Victor Postol is going to fight Danny Garcia. Put me among those who believes the title is going to change hands. Right again, I know I sound like a contrarian here, but Victor Postol moves better than Danny Garcia, has the faster hands than Danny Garcia, throws combinations, and is exactly the kind of high stamina guy, higher volume guy, with movement, who should be able to batter Danny Garcia. Right? Keep in mind, Garcia has been having problems making weight at 140. Now he's going to have to make weight, and he's going to have to do so against an active guy. Now, I'll concede that I've been calling for Danny Garcia's demise for a while now. Right? I thought Rod Salka would do a lot better against Danny Garcia. Right? Let's just say, in my opinion, Danny Garcia's championship reign is running out. Right? Perhaps Danny Garcia is going to prove me wrong. But I believe I've made a video on this fight already. Victor Postol against Danny Garcia. I think Postol's too fast for Danny Garcia. I think Garcia is a mid-range hooker who needs for the action to slow down a bit. When he gets in the ring with more advanced boxer types, think Mauricio Herrera, right? I believe Garcia has problems, right? I view Postol as better than Mauricio Herrera. Certainly has more hand speed, right? Let me also say this too. Look at the uppercut that ends his fight against Selkuk Aydın. You're going to realize that Postol isn't just hand speed. He's framing punches, right? I think Postol, at a minimum, is going to be a live underdog against Danny Garcia. Let's talk about other stories in the news. You know, people have a very hard time with the difference between an employer and an employee. Right? I often hear people say, who does this person think he is, expecting these privileges that typical employees don't get? Well, understand, if you're the employer, you set the rules. Right? You're the one who makes the decisions. Right? You're the one who is signing the front of checks and not the back of checks. Right? Understand that Floyd Mayweather is a CEO. Right? He's the employer. He's not working for anybody. I don't care how big the name is that he works with, right? Al Heyman, for example. Understand, Floyd's not working for Al Heyman. Al Heyman is working for Floyd Mayweather. Right? Understand, when you hear about a promotion and stuff like that, you know, Mayweather's really a free agent. Mayweather hires promoters, in the past Golden Boy Promotions, to promote his fights. It's not the reverse. Golden Boy doesn't dictate to Floyd Mayweather. Floyd Mayweather chooses the promoter who he's going to work with. He has his own promotional company, Mayweather Promotions. His business model is 180 degrees different from Manny Pacquiao's business model, right? So understand the story in the news today that Floyd is saying that neither his father nor Leonard Ellerbe speak for him on business matters is really a non-story, right? Floyd is the CEO. Floyd is the one making the decisions. Floyd is the only person authorized to announce his future fights, right? He's the one who decides who to delegate that authority to. Now, for people who are upset with that, who say, who does Floyd think he is and stuff like that, just ask yourself, when's the last time you asked, you know, who does my boss think he is? Right? If you're an employee, just ask yourself, who's setting the rules? Right? Don't begrudge the person who is the employer, the person who hired Leonard Ellerbe and who hired his father. Right? Let's not get carried away here, right? Just understand, if you want to know who Mayweather's fighting next, my advice to you is to simply listen to what Floyd has to say. And let's also not get upset when athletes, in this case a boxer, has power, right? Boxing isn't a salary cap league. I don't know what these brothers are doing in other sports, agreeing to salary caps and stuff like that without any upside equity participation. Seems like a bad deal to me, right? In boxing, let the free market dictate, right? Fighters should get whatever they can bargain for. That's the way I look at it. I'd rather the athletes have the power than these outfits filled with suits like Showtime and HBO or some mysterious pay-per-view operator who you never know or meet, or some promoter who has his own agenda of promoting certain fighters to titles, right? I have no problem with any fighter being his own boss and telling the public exactly who he is designating to be his public voice. Right? Let me finally say this. You know, I gave Gennady Golovkin's promoter a hard time here online in an earlier video. Right? This was when you were hearing a lot of nonsense. Right? A lot of poppycock over why Golovkin was dodging, avoiding fighting Andre Ward. You know, the simple reason Gennady Golovkin, you know, isn't fighting Andre Ward is because Ward would beat him badly. Right? Let's get real here. Right? Ward would beat him up. Right? Those times in Golovkin fights where he's open to counters, guess what? That's Andre Ward's bread and butter. So Golovkin's promoter, of course, was online talking about some lawsuit involving Andre and his promoter as if those legal problems would prevent Andre Ward from accepting a fight from Gennady Golovkin. Come on. Well, let me agree with the promoter on something. He's now issued a statement saying that Marco Antonio Rubio, Golovkin's next opponent, is going to be a tough matchup. Right now, keep in mind, the statement's significant because Rubio right now is a greater than 10-1 underdog. Let me just say, for one of the few times that I have read an article on this guy, I finally agree with Gennady Golovkin's promoter. I think Rubio's a live underdog. Right? At these odds, I believe he's a must play. Obviously, it's an easy hedge because you know Golovkin typically wins by KO. Right? There's certain fighters, no matter how limited you think they are, right? And let me just say, I consider Golovkin to be an elite fighter. Right? I don't consider Deontay Wilder to be an elite fighter. But let's just say, guys with knockout percentages in the Golovkin-Deontay Wilder neighborhood, it's an easy hedge. Just take those guys by KO. Right? So when a casino is offering you ridiculous upside participation, 10-1 odds on an opponent. In fact, I believe Rubio, the last time I looked, was something like 16-1. Right? To me, that's an opportunity. Because you can take that risk, take the 16-1 side, and you can hedge it with Golovkin by KO. If Golovkin does what Golovkin does best, you're hedged. You have the Golovkin by KO. Keep in mind, when you're getting 16-1 on one side of the aisle, the Golovkin by KO prop could even be a minus 300. What do you care? You can hedge that easily because you're getting 16-1 leverage on the other side of the play. But let me just warn everyone, as I've said in an earlier video, Marco Antonio Rubio stopped an unbeaten David Lemieux. Knocked him out. His corner threw in the towel. Understand, Marco Antonio Rubio went the distance against Julio Cesar Chavez Jr., a guy who was, let's just be charitable here, big for middleweight. Went the distance with him. Right? Don't you think that Rubio, who's also fought guys like Kelly Pavlik, don't you think that Rubio has the experience to actually go a few rounds with Gennady Golovkin? Right? Put Golovkin in that Danny Garcia class for me. Right? I thought Daniel Gill would do better against Golovkin in his last fight. Right? I'm waiting for the Golovkin car crash. There's going to be a fight where, even if Golovkin wins it, he's not going to look like Superman. He's going to be a little exposed. The things that he does that look great on film are going to suddenly look like defects. Right? We've seen it before. Right? Iron Mike Tyson. You know, there was a time where people thought Iron Mike Tyson was the best heavyweight since Prime Ali. People started talking about Tyson as possibly the best heavyweight ever. big time power in both hands. Could come inside, could kill you to the body or kill you to the head. Destroyed Marvis Frazer inside of a round with his father, heavyweight champion Joe Frazer, in Marvis's corner. Looked like a juggernaut, looked unstoppable. Buster Douglas meets him, operates behind a jab from distance, and as you were watching the fight, you thought to yourself, wow, how come we haven't seen anyone use length like this on Mike Tyson? Right? An even more intriguing fight. Evander Holyfield, not the ear-biting rematch, but the first fight, right? Holyfield decides to beat Tyson on the inside, right? Mike Tyson is so bewildered, right? Tyson claims Holyfield's hitting him with his head. The point, though, is if you look at the film of the later rounds of that fight before the stoppage, you're going to see Holyfield teeing off on Mike Tyson. Right? Superman, with all due respect to Adonis Stevenson, doesn't exist in boxing. Styles do. Right? Gennady Golovkin has to be on his front foot, not much of a back foot game. He's open for counters. He's a stalker. He looks invincible against overmatched competition. I'm just telling you that Rubio is exactly the kind of experienced vet who throws exactly the kind of straight punches to give Golovkin a hard time, right? When a guy's living by KOs, it's an easy hedge. Get the leverage from the casino by taking Rubio and hedge the play with Golovkin by KO. After the fight, Tom, Dick, Harry, Jane, and Joni can hop online if Golovkin wins by KO and says, ha ha ha, you were wrong. That's fine. I'll be in the line collecting on the hedge. Right? I'll be leaving with at least as much money in my bank account as I had before I made the bet. But if Rubio survives those early rounds, as he did against David Lemieux, a fight in which he's hurt early, and if Rubio starts finding a home for that straight right counter, and keep in mind, Rubio throws a pretty good straight left jab. And if Rubio pulls the upset, and keep in mind, when you're fighting Goliath, remember what Wilt Chamberlain famously said, no one roots for Goliath. When you're fighting Goliath and you're still on your feet at the start of the eighth round, there's a buzz in the crowd. Right, people start to say, whoa, wait a moment, what's going on here? How come Goliath isn't stomping out David? A lot of these fights where David beat Goliath, if you look at the replay of the fight, it's debatable. Right, George Foreman losing to Jimmy Young. Look at the replay. It's debatable whether Jimmy Young really beats George Foreman. Right, but understand, if Rubio's still standing upright in the 8th, 9th, 10th rounds, then it gets interesting, because then fans are going to swing. Life is fickle. They're going to start to say, wow, Golovkin is getting tested. Right? Some of those late close rounds might actually be awarded to the challenger. So pay close attention to that fight. Read the comments of Golovkin's promoter. I happen to agree with him. I think this is a competitive fight. Also, let me just tell you too. I mentioned Freddie Roach at the start of this video. I believe Freddie Roach could have made a difference in the Povetkin-Klitschko fight. I would have liked to have seen Teddy Atlas in Povetkin's corner. They had an association for a period of time. Well, understand, Marco Antonio Rubio has Robert Garcia in his corner. I'm telling you, don't just watch the boxers. Watch the trainers. Right? Garcia, and don't get me wrong, Abel Sanchez is an elite trainer. He's in Golovkin's corner. Sanchez is one of my favorite trainers too. But just understand, Sanchez is only one of two superstar trainers in that Golovkin-Rubio matchup, right? The one thing I know about Robert Garcia is that his guy is going to know how to throw straight punches, right? He even got Marcus Maidana to figure out how to throw a straight jab, right? So that fight is a live fight. You definitely want to mark that date on your calendar. Let me hear from you. Leave your comments for me here online. Visit us at gamblersadvisory.com. Thanks for stopping by.